الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الأمين الكريم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصل عليه. الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله، وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله. الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رحمة للعالمين، وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا خاتم النبيين. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد صلاة تشفينا، وسلم عليه سلاما يداوينا، وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. All praises to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salutations, blessings, peace, mercy descend and shower upon the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the best of creation, the beloved of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the best of messengers, the final prophet, the dearest to our hearts, the love of our lives, the purpose of our lives, none other than Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and upon his family and his noble companions. Alhamdulillah, I was invited to this spiritual retreat by Qibla Shah Sahib and Qibla Sahibzada Sahib. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect them both, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give the tawfiq to benefit from both of their nisbahs and the association to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What Shah Sahib said about me is not me, first of all. But like the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala state that if you want to be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you, then try to make any deed in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regardless how big or small it is. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might accept the smaller deeds in comparison to the bigger deeds. So you might think something is really big, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might not accept that from you. But if you consider the smaller things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept that from you. So never pass this opportunity to do these deeds in front of others or towards others. If somebody gives you the opportunity to pour them water, then jump at that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might accept it from you. If somebody gives you the opportunity to serve them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that jump at the opportunity, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might accept that and make you from the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It only takes an instant. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you the ulum of this dunya and the hereafter and put you into the divan of the awliya. So always jump towards the opportunity. And this is what we're here for. This is not me just speaking to you, rather it's for myself. I'm here for myself. Whatever rizq Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to give you in terms of my words, then that's your rizq. But I'm here for myself because I'm in need of forgiveness. Because I'm in need of salvation, I'm in need of the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we have our own benefits. When I'm talking to you, I'm actually giving nasiha to myself. Because we are all sinners. And we're all in need of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to intercede for us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the why we jump at the opportunity, like you were saying, jump at the opportunity, because we have this in mind, because we need on forgiveness. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us that forgiveness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us on the way of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. this is the topic that I was given, which was in regards to the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the importance of having a sheikh.
Subhanallah.
These are the two things that I was given and the need of a sheikh.
Subhanallah.
So the first topic, which is the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is not hidden upon you, because anybody who's part of the Ahlul Sunnah automatically knows the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we mentioned this many times, only one door leads to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's the door of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we say to those people who think that they can reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you're completely wrong. There's no other door leading to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala other than the door of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For you to try to gain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without gaining the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is pointless if you do not honor the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I'm going to begin on the narration which has just come to my mind now. And I mentioned this a few days ago in a dars, and that was Imam Zahabi rahimahullah ta'ala quoting his Kitab al-Qabair, the book of major sins. And under Uquq al-Walidain, disobeying the parents, he narrates the saying of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, Hibrul Ummah, the Mufassir of the Quran. The Mufassir of this Ummah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught him the tafsir of the Quran. Rather did dua for him that, oh Allah, make him from the Mufassir of the Quran. And he was the first one. Now he writes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept three things without three things. Mentioned this couple of times before. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept three things without three things. And they all mentioned in the Quran. And they all mentioned together. The first one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept you being obedient to Him if you're not obedient to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Atiyu Allah wa Rasul, atiyu Allah wa atiyu Rasul. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned them together. That is the first sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept being obedient to Him, to do the itaat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without doing the itaat of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept your itaat. You can pray how many namazah you like, how many salahs you like, but have no itaat of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept you loving Him if you don't have love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas then states that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept your salah if you do not pay your zakat. Why? وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُ الزَّكَاةَ. These two things are mentioned together. So you pray all your life and not pay your zakat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept it from you. Then he states, and this is for us as well, as a nasiha, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept you praising Him and being thankful to Him if you are not thankful to your parents. Anishkurli wali walidayka ilayya al-masir. And thank your parents, those who brought you into this world. Thank them, إِلَيَّ الْمَسِيرِ, for your return is towards me. The ultimate return is towards me. Many are going to be questionable on that day of judgment when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have you in front of Him. And He will say to you that you have always been thankful to me. You have always praised me, but have you thanked your parents? They were your wasila in coming into this dunya. So have you thanked them? So our purpose is the first one. That without the itaat of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you don't have the itaat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Without the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you cannot have the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the only thing that leads to the itaat of Allah is the itaat of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They're of the same kind. To follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to have this utmost respect as Muslims. And it's unfortunate that in this day and age that even Muslims do not have respect for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us away from those people. Because it's like cancer. And once you come close to them, then what happens? The cancer takes over. It infects you also. It's like a virus. Sheikh B. Jamaat Ali Shah rahimahullah ta'ala is known for this, that certain deviants, he was in jail once. And most of my family is bad to Pee Jamaat Ali Shah. My granddad was directly bad to Pee Jamaat Ali Shah. some of my grandparents were khalifas of Jamaat al-Isha also. And the Mufti of Azad Kashmir, my mom's uncle, Mufti Abdul Hakim, he was a good friend of Jamaat al-Isha also, one of the best friends of Jamaat al-Isha. He's actually, I think, with his brother, Sheikh Alam, who was a direct khalifa of Jamaat al-Isha also. Now, it's interesting about him that when he was in jail, one of the MNAs or whatever they have in Pakistan in terms of politicians, he would act as an Ahlul Sunnah scholar. And he would come and do taqreer and get the votes of the Ahlul Sunnah people in Islamic gathering. But one day he walked in and this gathering, thousands of people present. And the rest of the scholars, the Zahiri scholars, they all stood up for him, shook his hands, hugged him. Jamaat al-Isha rahimahullah just stayed sitting. This politician, he stood and he started blaming Jamaat al-Isha that, you know, what kind of person is he, how, I mean, what kind of alim is he, what kind of Sufi is he, that he doesn't stand up to give salam or even hug a person, do musahfa with him, shake hands with him. He did his taqreer, whatever, Jamaat al-Isha had the final khitab. And they said, the first thing they said was, the reason I did not hug you or shake hands with you or even give you salam, the reason is that you have a hatred and a fire burning inside you, which is of the hatred of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. This was strange to his heart. Yes? And I fear that the fire which I have of the love of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, that if I hug you, you'll take it out. These were the awliyas. See how cancer can spread. So this is why they didn't hug him. Then all that majma knew that this person was the Shi'i. All his life he was hiding between the Ahlul Sunnah and taking their votes. Right? But that day everybody found out that he was a Shi'i. And he affirmed it afterwards himself. Yes, I come from a family of Shia. So you understand that these things are a virus. And be careful of that, because you have a fire burning of the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And anybody can take that out. It's a cancer. So you have to protect yourself dearly. Stay away from those people. And this is the importance of a Shaykh as well, because he gives you that balance. I'm going to talk about that in later on, inshaAllah ta'ala. That's the importance of a Shaykh, that he gives you some kind of balance in the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his love, in the love of the brothers amongst you, in brotherhood. All this is part of tariqah. So having this love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is vital. Balki the whole deen is based upon that. The whole deen is based upon that. The love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the Quran. For Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the Sharia. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Islam itself.
Subhanallah.
So without having love for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you can't have love for anything else. You can't have love for anything else. So this is why it's important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Quran, common verse which is recited, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِ, that if you love, if you claim to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then what? Follow me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I'll say to the people, if you have love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then follow me, follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yuhbibkumullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you.
Subhanallah.
So following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam leads to the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, first of all. But understand here that there's one part missing. To follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have to have love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then love the Prophet. The love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will lead you to following every single thing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. Once you have that, then you attain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or rather, the other way around, yuhbibkumullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you.
Subhanallah.
Okay? From starting off to being the one who loves. Being the Habib in terms of the Muhib. You start your journey as a Muhib, but your journey ends up being the Habib.
Subhanallah.
Okay, you understand that? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Habib, but in terms of you, you start your journey as claiming love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it's not mutual. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not declared that He loves you as of yet. But your journey starts, you move to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You become the Muhib of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then you start fulfilling everything the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in his life, the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam declares that I have love for this certain person.
Subhanallah.
Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will declare that I have also love for this person. And it reminds you of the hadith that in the heavens Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, once He loves a person, He tells Sayyidina Jibreel, Jibreel do ilan between the angels of the heaven that I have looked for so and so person. Then the ilan is done to them, the angels in heaven. Then the angels of heaven are told to tell the angels of the earth. Then the angels of the earth have been told, then it goes into the awliya. The awliya tell the people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has looked for these certain people. Why do you think the name lives after they pass from the Zahiri world? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared to everybody. Even kuffar will let you know that they are the men of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know the story that jinn also go towards the heavens, okay, closer to the skies, and they snatch certain truths and then add 100 lies to it, like Rasulullah s.a.w. Sahihi stated, that they snatch a certain truth and they add 100 lies and they come to these psychic people and let them know that, but it has that truth. And what happened? For example, Khawaja Ghareeb Nawaz, everybody comes to his grave. Everybody comes to his grave. There's many other awliyas around the world who even kuffar come to. Is even known to us that people, certain psychics or magicians, whoever, they say if you go to so and so place, a very place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieve you of your illness, for example. But where has that magician or that psychic, where have you learned it from? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made that ilan to Sayyidina Jibreel. Sayyidina Jibreel has made it to the angels of heaven, and the angels of heaven have made it to the angels of the earth, and the jinn in between have snatched it. So, but what happened? The whole dunya knows that he's a man of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has looked for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has looked for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, Rasulullah has looked for him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has looked for him. So these are the great men of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But to learn the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, love of Rasulullah, you have to attach yourself to these people. The nisbah has to be kind. You're not going to gain the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam just by yourself. The nisbah has to be kind, because this love has adab and adab. You have to have etiquette and manners. Without manners and etiquette, you can't have the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In class earlier, we was talking, in the Aqidah Tahawiyyah class, just after Asr, we was talking about the if prophets can sin and things like this, this masla in Aqaid. And we had a simple answer to it, that why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes reveal certain verses which seem like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being harsh with the anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we answer this question by saying that there's a saying between the awliya, the sin done at the door is greater than the mistake, the lapse in adab at the table is greater than the sin that's done at the door. I mentioned this last time in the Jummah as well here. So this is the reason also. So you take this for yourself now. That was answering the Anbiya, but take it for yourself. When you are in front of your Shaykh, that lapse in adab could mean your dismissal from the zikr gathering.
Oh,
our shuyukh are known for that, very strict. Certain shuyukh in the zikr gathering are strict. But because of the day and age we are in, and the society we live in, we don't have that adab within us. We're not naturally brought up with it. So we have to learn. So this is why you find so many of the shuyukh be lenient with you. They take your burden. And this is one of the reasons for having a shaykh as well, because he takes your burden. We had it in our zikr gathering also. Imam Sha'rani rahimahullah ta'ala in Adab al-Sobha mentions that the shaykh that sat in the front of the zikr gathering, he's taking all your burden. The afat and the musibah that were coming upon you, the shaykh has taken it. That's why he has sleepless nights. That's why he actually finds it harder to do the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he does the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gets a great reward for it. Because he had to tackle all your musibat. So that's the need of a shaykh as well. That's the mercy of the shuyukh towards you, that he's taking on that musibat upon himself. Imam Sha'rani writes that the shuyukh, they take so much burdens of the awam that they become like mountains. That Balki goes one step and he states that if those musibats were to come upon a mountain, the mountain would explode. But the shaykh does not explode. But it's the blessing and the love of Rasulullah that they became like this. The heart was revealed, the Quran was revealed upon the heart of the Prophet, which could blow up mountains if it was revealed upon mountains. But because of that blessing of Rasulullah, he distributed that strength amongst the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that now they can carry the burden of the ummah. They carry the burden of the ummah. So that's why we have shuyukh also. So back to the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is all linked to the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's nothing different. Ana qasim wallahu yuti. I am the distributor, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives me. Whatever attribute you find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sallallahu alaihi wasallam has somewhere in the ummah has distributed it. This he distributed. He has a heart which is strong, which can handle the Quran being revealed upon it. See, the Aisha states that when the Quran was revealed upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and if he sallallahu alaihi wasallam sat on a camel, the camel, it would seem that the camel's back is about to break. That's how heavy the revelation would be. But this strong heart, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has also given it to the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to carry your burdens. So we have to have almost love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this love has to have adab and etiquettes and manners, and we have to abide by it. Now, one of the etiquettes is that whatever the mahbub does, the muhib has to do. Whatever the mahbub does, the muhib has to do. This is why, according to some ulama, every action that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed in front of them, in terms of being example for the Sahaba, then it was necessary upon the Sahaba to follow it. There was no other way about it. There was no other way about it. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam read Sunnah, if they seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam read Sunnah, then they had to read Sunnah as well. That was the way about it. Our deen has progressed. Obviously, we have authentication and how we authenticate things. But for the Sahaba, they were seeing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they had to follow it. And this is why you see that Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, he would be strict and be adherent to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam Sunnah wherever he could and be strict upon it. Even to the extent that if little children were against the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would correct them. The smallest Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was the biggest Sunnah for him, he would find it and do that. Sahih Bukhari is filled that he was known for going out to Medina Sharif and looking for places where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed his prayer. He would go around and find where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or try to remember himself, or go to the companions, or you went on a journey with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Where did the Prophet read Fajr? Where did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam read Zuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha? And you find those places, and you go there and exactly pray where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed. Blessed maqam. And you will pray there. If the Prophet prayed there, my du'as will be accepted there as well. So he would do this. Where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go under a branch. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar in old age, he's blind. The branch no longer there, but he still does exactly the same action. The Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The adab of it as well. That whenever you know the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you do not belittle it by not doing it. You make sure you do it. And this is what it also means of taqwa. One of the meanings of taqwa is to be conscious. To be conscious of when you have love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the mean conscious of the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you know you can do a certain Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then why leave it? To the start what I was talking about. That every deed could mean your forgiveness. It could mean your forgiveness. If you know that I can do this Sunnah, then do it so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive you. Do it so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may make you from the awliya. You do it for these reasons. So the love of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is necessity. It's necessary in the deen. Like we stated. It stated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Salasun man kunna fihi wajada halawat al-imani." There are three things. Whoever they found in, he has tasted the sweetness of iman. Now we need to ask ourselves how we taste the sweetness of iman, because it's actually dying out in this day and age. Only a select few of people have tasted the iman, and the three things are: an yakun Allah wa rasuluhu أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِمَّا سِوَاهُمَا. That Allah and His Messenger are more beloved to Him than anything else.
Subhanallah.
Do we find that? Do we find that? We don't find that sometimes. We prioritize other things over the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? Because if this was prioritized, then we would see the masajid full. We would see the masajid full. was reading regarding Sayyidina Abdul Umar bin Abdul Aziz, the first Mujaddid, regarding him, that whenever his house always attached to the masjid. And like the ulama state, that if your wife can declare that you're a wali of Allah, then you're truly a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because she knows your true state. In front of us and everybody else, you can be whatever you like. You can deceive us. But if you go home and you're told you something else, then you truly deceived us. But if your wife declares that you are a truly a man of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then know you're truly a man of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But she knows your reality inside out. Now she states about Sayyidina Umar bin Abdul Aziz, Fatima bint Abdul Malik. She states that I have not seen a man more fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than him. Meaning he had the khawf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above any other man I've seen. When he would leave the masjid, he would leave himself, his nafs was still inside the masjid. His nafs was still inside the masjid, and you come to the house and you just cry until you come back to the masjid. And he's the leader of his time, the mujaddid of his time. He's the king of his time. So this is how we need to be. That if we truly had the fear and the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we would prioritize the ahkam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the ahkam of Rasulullah, the love of Allah and the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam above everything else. And make sure that we fulfill the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because that's what love wants. Love isn't just a claim that I have love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It needs evidence. And the evidence is you following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For that is the etiquette and the adab of loving Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Of this love. If you do not follow the love of Rasulullah, then it's just an empty claim. That's all that's left. Just an empty claim that I have love for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But on the day of judgment, we'll find that this claim doesn't mean anything to us. When he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, what have you done in the dunya? I had love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What's your evidence? Nothing, because there's nothing in the scale. So we have to provide that. We have to say, yes, this is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's fulfill this and this and this. And then you'll find on the day of judgment that your scale be going sky high. The scales are upside down in on the day of judgment. According to one narration, the heavier the scale gets, the higher it goes up. It doesn't go down, there's no gravity. It goes upwards this time. So this is one thing that the ulama mentioned. But if you want to fill that with the love of the Prophet ﷺ by acting upon the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, this is what love wants. The reward of this love with the Prophet ﷺ, one is the Quran which we recited, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you. But that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loving you, but what reward will He give you by Him loving you? That's another thing. You do one action and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you for it. But in the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you also and He will also grant you a reward.
Subhanallah.
He's granting you two things. Now here we have that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a man, a Bedouin came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when is the final day? The day of judgment. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ma a'dadta laha, what have you prepared for it? What have you prepared for it? And he said, Ma a'dadtu laha min kaseeri salatin wala sawmin wala sadaqatin. I've not prepared abundant amounts of prayers, okay, salat, namaz, nor have I prepared abundant amount of fasting, nor have I prepared abundant amount of sadaqah. ولكني أحب الله ورسوله. But I have love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the only thing I've prepared. That's the only thing I've prepared. Meaning this is what I prepared for the day of judgment. But with dalil. With dalil that he is affirming everything in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's affirming everything in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather him to see Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a dalil itself. Radiallahu anhu wa radu an. He became part of that clan. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is happy with them and they are happy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just by his sight, seeing Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sallallahu alaihi wasallam seeing him. He became forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qala anta ma'a man ahbabta. Now the reward. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, the reward of this, you having looked for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and having looked for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is anta ma'a man ahbabta. You are going to be with whomever you love.
Subhanallah.
Whoever you have looked for, you will be resurrected with him.
Mashallah.
If you have looked for your Shaykh, which leads to the love of Rasulullah. The love of Rasulullah leads to the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, because he has looked for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he has looked for the awliya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you. Yes? The beloved of the beloved is the beloved. Yes? The beloved of the beloved is the beloved. So because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the Prophet and loves the awliya, he will have love for you, because the Prophet and the awliya have love for you now. So this is another importance of having a shaykh. If you want to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to love you. Sometimes what happens as well is that you might not be perfect yourself, but the awliya are perfect. And you just be around them. You just be around them, maybe you probably don't even do anything. Just pray your prayers on time and that's about it. And now you probably read nafil prayer. Not do anything extra. But just because you're known to be around the awliya, you're known to be part of them, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala treats you as the awliya.
Subhanallah.
It's not the dog of the Ashabi Kaf. Look at him. He was counted amongst them.
Subhanallah.
He was counted amongst them. But he's still a dog and he's going to go to heaven. What about yourselves as humans, the best of creation, who lingers around the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like the dog of the Ashabi Kaf did? Then why won't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put you amongst the register of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He'll definitely put you amongst them. But all is, you need to be around them, but with adab. Adab is the key to success. So look here, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated this. Another hadith, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated, Al-mar'u ma'a man ahab. That a man is with him and resurrected with him, whom he loves. Whoever he has looked for, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect with him. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once a man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَأَنْتَ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ أَهْلِي وَمَالِي وَإِنِّي لَأَذْكُرُكَ فَمَا أَصْبِرُ حَتَّى أَجِيءَ فَأَنْظُرَ إِلَيْكَ. He came to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, I have almost looked for you. Almost looked. You're the dearest person to me, to an extent that you're more dearest to me than my own family, than my own wealth, and you're dearest to me to anything in the dunya. And he said, وَإِنِّي لَأَذْكُرُكَ. But Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I remember you and I mention you, or every time mention is made of you, فَمَا أَصْبِرُ حَتَّى أَجِيَ. I don't have this patience within inside me, and that I become so impatient that I have to come in front of you. I come in front of you, فَأَنْظُرَ إِلَيْكَ, then I look towards you. وَإِنِّي ذَكَرْتُ مَوْتِي وَمَوْتَكَ. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, when I come here, I quench my thirst, that you're in front of me, and just because of your illuminated light within you, it puts me to sukoon, brings tranquility inside me. But Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, something that depresses me is, Ya Rasulullah, I am going to leave this world and you are going to leave this world. This is a final world. فَعَرَفْتُ أَنَّكَ إِذَا دَخَلْتَ الْجَنَّةَ. And I know this, Ya Rasulullah, that with yakin, that when you are going to enter heaven, and while you're being entered in, when you enter heaven, you are going to be raised with the Anbiya. You're going to be amongst the Anbiya. وَإِن دَخَلْتُهَا لَا أَرَاكَ. And if I enter heaven, he didn't say yakin for himself. He said yakin for the Prophet. He says, Ya Rasulullah, you will enter heaven. And you will be with the Anbiya, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise your maqam with the Anbiya. But if I enter heaven, so look at the adab there, how he's talking to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's not saying yakin that, and when I enter heaven. No, if I enter heaven, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, La araka, I won't see you. Because you're with the Anbiya. So how am I going to quench my thirst then? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited the verse, فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. Rather, one of the nuzul, sabab-e-nuzul of this Quranic verse, is this waqi'. This ayat came, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا.
سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ.
Common verse we recite. What's that? وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ. Whoever does the itaat is obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَأُولَٰئِكَ. They are those مَعَ الَّذِينَ who are with, they will be resurrected with, they will be entered into heaven with. With those أَنَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed His blessings upon, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ni'mah is upon. And who are those people? مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ, from the Prophets. Sayyidul Anbiya is our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did a'lan to this Bedouin or this Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that don't worry. You feel that you won't see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? If you have looked for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and looked for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you have obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obedience to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then you are going to be resurrected with Sayyidul Anbiya. That's the meaning of that verse of the Quran. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Sayyidul Anbiya. So the first person with the Siddiqeen, with the Shuhada, with the Salihin. And look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. And what a great حَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ, that what a great companionship this is. What a great companionship this is. So Rafiqa, you use the word dost. Okay, sangi dost. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. What a great sangi this is. حَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. حَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. What a great companionship and a great friendship this is, and a great friend this is, to be resurrected with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is also stated that there were certain people. Sayyidina Ali karamallahu wajhahu al-kareem was asked, كَيْفَ كَانَ حُبُّكُمْ لِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ sallallahu alaihi wasallam? That how was your love for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And he answered, كَانَ وَاللَّهِ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْنَا مِنْ أَمْوَالِنَا وَأَوْلَادِنَا وَآبَائِنَا وَأُمَّهَاتِنَا وَمِنَ الْمَاءِ الْبَارِدِ أَلَّا الزَّمَائِ. He answered by saying that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was more beloved to us by God. By the oath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was more beloved to us than what? More than our wealth, more than our offspring, more than our fathers, more than our mothers. And He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was more beloved to us than cold water when we are thirsty. Imagine being in the desert and you are thirsty. You are thirsty and cold water can only quench your thirst. Rasulullah was more beloved to them than that. And he actually reflected that when Sayyidina Ali was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he sallallahu was sleeping in the lap of Sayyidina Ali karamallahu wajhahu al-kareem. What happened? He left his asr prayer to be obedient to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He left his asr prayer for the love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That the muhib cannot disturb the mahbub in whatever he's doing. It does not disturb him. So he did not disturb the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he carried on with what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was doing. But then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rewarded him by bringing the sun back. This is why Allah Hazrat says, Sabit huwa ke asrul usul bandagi is tajwarki hai. That from this waqiyah of Sayyidina Ali, you find out that the asrul usul, the root of all roots, is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That even prayer, which is the follower of the sun, to work out what prayer time it is, you have to look towards the sun. To work out if it's Zohr, Asr, okay, and Maghrib, then the sun sets, okay, and like the rest of the prayers, you look towards the sun. So the prayers have to follow the sun. But the sun is following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is moving at the indication of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In this waqiyah of Sayyidina Ali karamallahu wajhahu al-kareem, so you find out that even the sun has almost looked for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at ulama, have written books upon this. How the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has looked for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How they would come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The tree stumped. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's member was made, the tree stumped and started crying. A lifeless thing is crying for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine that, a lifeless thing, a tree, is crying for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until the Sahaba heard it crying. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came down from the minbar, went to the tree and stroked it like a baby, and then he stopped crying. This is a look for it. The ulama state that this tree, if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't calm it down, it would have cried till the day of Jum'ah and the whole world would have been flooded. The whole world would have been flooded. But the Prophet ﷺ had condoned it. The ulama also state that, look here as well, there's a certain meaning here. That you claim, look for Rasulullah ﷺ, but look here, the tree, Rasulullah ﷺ has only moved a few yards away from it. How far was that, the Hunayn, how far was it from the member of the Prophet ﷺ? A few yards, few meters, couple of meters from the tree stump. But yet, it felt that it's away from the Prophet ﷺ. But what about us? Do we ever shed a tear that the Prophet ﷺ is far away from us? 14 centuries have passed. 14 centuries have passed. Have we ever shed a tear for the Prophet ﷺ? This is how far we are away from the Prophet ﷺ by time. We are miles and miles away from the Prophet ﷺ by distance. By distance, by miles. We are miles away from the Prophet ﷺ. Do we feel in our heart that this love we claim for the Prophet ﷺ? But has it affected our hearts? I'm not with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Does it bring a tear? No. So you find out that this tree stump is better than us. That he had almost looked for the Prophet, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was only a few yards away. But he couldn't bear the separation from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Likewise, you have animals respecting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They look for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's many waqiyat in that as well. How animals will come to the Prophet ﷺ and respect and honor the Prophet ﷺ. Whatever the Prophet ﷺ will tell them, they will fulfill it. Once the Prophet ﷺ, there was a deer which was trapped. A man was hunting and he trapped the deer. The deer spoke to the Prophet ﷺ and said, I have small deers who need feeding. I need to get back to them. The Prophet ﷺ placed his own foot into the trap and let the deer go. And the man, the owner of that trap, said, yes, that was mine. It's not going to come back. The Prophet ﷺ said, it will come back.
Subhanallah.
But look at the obedience of this deer to the Prophet ﷺ. As soon as it fed its own children, it came back and placed its own foot in the trap, and the Prophet ﷺ had taken his blessed feet out. The obedience to that. Obedience to the Prophet ﷺ. Which meant that it was obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find out even animals are better than us. We have just empty claim. We have just empty claim. We sometimes don't follow the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At that time in our house, we should know now that this deer is better than us. For it is obedient to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you have many riwayat in this. One riwayat was, look at the love she had for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A lady came to Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And she said to Sayyidah Aisha, that ikshifi li qabra Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, open the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for me. This young lady came. Sayyidah Aisha opened the door for her. She went inside. Fabakat, she started crying, and that was the cause of her death. That's how much love she had for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That young lady just walked in, Sayyidah Aisha, and asked to see the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And she saw the grave of the Prophet, she started crying, and that crying was the cause of her death. But she wasn't crying for any odd reason. She was crying because she could not see the Prophet ﷺ anymore. In the dunya we're talking about. In the spiritual realm, the awliya see the Prophet ﷺ. But because she wasn't physically seeing the Prophet ﷺ, she couldn't bear that separation away from the Prophet ﷺ. And this became the cause of her passing from this dunya. So there's many narrations within this. So we have to have obedience to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Have love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But this love, this obedience, comes in manners and etiquettes. And this is where the Shaykh falls into it. This is where tariqah falls into it. This is where you have to take a hand of a person who has held the hand of his Shaykh, who in return held the hand of his Shaykh, all the way to the Sahaba Ikram who held the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had taken it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the knowledge has been passed down. But you see, when it joins to the Sahaba told the Tabi'in the etiquettes they had around Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Tabi'in had those etiquettes around the Sahaba Ikram. Then the Taba Tabi'in had those etiquettes around the Tabi'in, and it passed down these manners and etiquettes. These secrets were passed down also. Now the sheikh's job and the importance of having a sheikh is that he restores some kind of balance in your life. Other than that, you're just not, you're not similar to these people who are deviants. Wake up one day and say, I read a hadith about reading 100 nawafil in the night. So that day you're trying to implement 100 nawafil in the night. The next day there's nothing, no sign of 100 nawafil. Now you read another hadith that I should do this amal, I should read this dua in the morning. So you do that for 2 or 3 days and then after 2 or 3 days that amal has finished. Then you find another hadith and then you start implementing that. You know, some of these Salafis are slightly confused.com. They really don't know what's going on. They mention one hadith one day and they read it and they implement it. The next day they find another hadith which contradicts the first hadith and they start implementing that. There's no balance in that. The Shaykh gives you balance. Your teachers give you balance. Balance in terms of tasawwuf is slightly different. They give you balance in what? In istiqamah. In balance in istiqamah in what you need to do. What's right for you at the right times. If I was to come and you, I say to you, okay, now you have to read the Hajjud all night, you have to do your Ababeen and all these things, right? You have to do 70,000 istighfar in one day. Okay? You have to do 70,000 La ilaha illallah one day. You need to do 100,000 Allahus in one day. You'll probably get to 1,000 and say, that's it, I'm going home. It's not going to happen. Likewise, if you told you to do a specific act every single day, but in a huge amount. Take a week, 2 weeks, you'll have none of it. But what do the awliya do? They restore some kind of balance to you. They say, okay, you need to start your istighfar now. Do your istighfar, okay? Do this with, three cars are slightly different from each other. So they say, okay, do your istighfar, 70,000 istighfar. Once you've done that, then do your la ilaha illallah. Then once you've done that, now start your wird. So now this wird needs to be done at this time. Build upon that. Or even before that, if a person is not reading his 5 daily prayers, they say, okay, do istighfar as well, do your 5 daily prayers, complete your 5 daily prayers, and do my jamaat. Or some shuyukh even say that for 40 days, you have to do prayer, 5 daily prayers in jamaat, and you can't miss a single jamaat. If you miss one, you have to start the 40 days again. You get shuyukh like that as well. So once you've done that, now he's used to jamaat. So now he's done that, okay, now move to something else. Now move to your will. So he's restoring some kind of balance to you. He's guiding along the way. Okay, now you've implemented that. You're steadfast upon that. Nobody can take that away from you. Okay, now add this touch to it. Add this part to it. Now you build on that. You build more and more and more. Okay, read some salawat now. Okay, start with 100 salawat a day. Then next, after you've got used to a month of that, reading 100 salawat a day, okay. Now you used to do 200, 300, 400, okay. Now you go to a stage, now you can recite the Lail al-Khairat. Recite the whole of the Lail al-Khairat throughout the week. And so on and so forth, you build up. But without the Shaykh, then you're just an ugly duckling just going from one place to the other. You don't know what's going on. You don't know, you know, one day I'll start istighfar, the next day I might be doing La ilaha illallah. But the istighfar is finished now. So the shuyukh are there for some kind of balance towards you. And I have a book in front of me, Lawaqi al-Anwar al-Qudusiyya fi Biyan al-Uhud al-Muhammadiyya. It's in Arabic, I don't know if it's been translated, but it's a brilliant book by Imam Sha'rani rahimahullah ta'ala. He has literally everything of Sharia in here, and at the end of it he says, find a shaykh, he'll restore some balance for you. But he gives you aspects of the deen, even in namaz, he gives you certain aspects which you think you couldn't even think of. But he tells you that the Shaykh will teach you this. The tasawwuf doesn't come from books. The tasawwuf comes from the being at the feet of the awliya. Yeah? And the reason for that is because of that connection we said. Yeah? They come from that. You can read books all day. It doesn't mean you can implement it. And that's the secret as well. When you could read books all day and you might not implement a single thing. But you sit at the feet of the awliya. Sitting at the feet of the awliya has such barakah in it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala automatically gives you tawfiq to do the action. So you might be reading something all day about prayer or whatever, but you find yourself struggling to do it. You sit at the feet of the awliya and your shaykh, you'll find that just because of his tawajjuh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you the tawfiq to do it. Tawfiq is everything. Without tawfiq, you can't do anything. The ability to do the action. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the ability, that's when you can perform the action. This is why all the Sufiya also say the adab of making dua is never to say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that give me, make me a person who can do so many prayers, a person who can do so many things. But all you just ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give me the tawfiq. Because tawfiq has everything in it, it's a jam'i dua. Just give me ability to worship you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the ability to do various things. So this is one of the points of having the shuyukh and the importance of having shuyukh. That they give you some, restore some balance in your life, in implementation, and they work up with you. As opposed to you trying to just pick up anything from Sharia and trying to implement it, because it's not going to last for long. So this is one thing. And then knowing the importance of each and every single thing. The shuyukh teach you that as well. The importance of your prayer, the importance of zakat, the importance of song. And why you need to do them, the importance of being pious as well, which we miss. Sometimes you find many people like that. And especially in this day and age, you find people who are praying their prayer, but they do everything wrong in the community. They might be paying their zakat, but they're doing everything wrong in the community. So you find that the shaykh is there to restore that balance. Okay, I know you pray your prayer, but you're doing all these things wrong as well. So now you need to work on these things. So he will teach you that. So this is the importance of having the shuyukh. And for example, you know, Imam Sha'rani rahimahullah ta'ala, at the end of each one, he says that you need to find a shaykh to restore this balance. A shaykh to teach you how your prayer should be. You know, because there is going to be a time where, you know, you learn about fiqh. You learn where to fasten your hands, how to do your takbir, you know, how to move into certain positions. Okay? But is that what all namaz is? No, you shaykh hum zini. This is where you get the tasawwur of ismizaj, don't you?
Okay?
Then now you need to move towards that. Forget the dunya around you. Now you're in prayer. Forget where you're looking at your finger and you're going to lift it up, or isn't he lifting it, or are your feet straight? No. That's the beginning stage, where you do so much prayers and so much nawafil, now that you just become autopilot in those positions. Do you ever realize you're doing certain actions in namaz? Sometimes it's just automatic. Sometimes you might be thinking about other stuff in prayer, but your actions are happening automatically. But imagine now, the wali or the sheikh, he will tell you, okay, now look at the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and become absorbed within that.
Subhanallah.
So when you're in prayer, you're just looking towards the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in front of your eyes. It doesn't have to be literally in front of you, it's just embedded in your eyes. You're looking at the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you're not in touch with the dunya. And the dunya is yourself as well. So you're not looking towards your own actions. But how are you going to learn that from books? It's not going to happen from books. It can only happen on the hands of the shiur. It can only happen on the hands of the shiur. This is where the tawajjuh comes into it as well. In the Naqshbandi tariqah, we have the tawajjuh. Doing tawajjuh towards the other person. That tawajjuh is actually restoring balance into you. And we talked about that burden. That tawajjuh is really taking the burden off your heart and the shaykh taking it. This is why Imam Sha'rani rahimahullah in the Adab al-Sawba writes that certain shiur, they do certain tawajjuhs, that they are close to becoming destroyed. Because they carry the burden of the Ummah of the Prophet. But Allah subhanahu will not destroy them, but they come close to it. They come close to it. So you understand their job as well. So what happens? You come with all this impurity within the hearts. What's the Shaykh's job? When he does that one tawajjuh towards your heart, he can clear all that. But that impurity has to go somewhere. The Shaykh takes it. He takes it upon himself, and because he's a shaykh, he's a man of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives it.
Subhanallah.
But he has to carry that burden first. He has to carry that burden. So this is the importance of having a shuyukh. And then he's the exemplar of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because we are people who need to see things as well. And again, we read many certain... I'll give you an example. There's a hadith, it's a musalsal hadith, regarding the musafa, the shaking of the hands. Okay, the hadith is about something else, but while this hadith was taken by the companion, the Prophet ﷺ shook his hand in a certain way. So when he narrated it, He narrated it to the Sahabi by shaking hands in the same way. And it carried on until it came to the Muhaddiseen. It's still being passed on now. So the question is, you read that in Hadith that the Prophet shook hands with a certain Sahabi in this certain way. There's no way from the words that are written that you know how the Prophet shook hands with him. So what happens? When you come to the feet of the Shuyukh and you take the hand of the Shaykh, that's when you realize how the Prophet shook his hands. So he's just become an example of the Sunnah of the Prophet.
Allah
And there are many things as well, because there's ikhtilafat in the Sunnah as well, in certain things, how the Prophet did that. And this is where the Shaykh also restores balance for you. Your eyes shouldn't be, am I the best brother, am I looking the best? You should look your best as well, that's the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you present yourself in the best of manners. Okay? But you never go against the look of your brother. That's the adab of Sohbah as well. The adab being around your friends. You never go against the person and say, why are you wearing this, why are you wearing that? Okay? You always be respectful towards him. But you don't look towards your brothers, rather your first point of call to know the Sunnah of the Prophet should be your Shaykh. When you look at him, you're confused. Did the Prophet say in this manner while eating? Did he say in this manner while eating? No. If your Shaykh is sat in one particular manner, then that's the way the Prophet sat. That's the way the Prophet sat. If you're confused how the Prophet used to eat, then no, look towards your Shaykh, you will know how the Prophet ate. For example, we were confused regarding how the Prophet ﷺ would take the seed of the date out of his mouth. There's an ikhtilaf between the ulama in this. And our Shaykh then mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ, we know for a fact the Prophet ﷺ took it out with his right hand. But the ulama argued that when you pick up another date, then the saliva would pass on. Your germs would pass on to the other people. You're contaminating the food. So there's a debate amongst this. Imam Suyuti rahimahullah mentions this as well. But then our Shaykh from Imam Suyuti taught us that the Prophet ﷺ would eat the date and then he would bring out the seed of the date onto the tip of his lips with his tongue and then place it on top of his two fingers. So he would not grab it with those fingers. So you learn the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Our Shaykh also taught us how to eat figs. How the Prophet would eat figs, that has been taught. So you have all these things to know, but the best port of call for you is your own Shaykh. Because he restores balance to you. It doesn't mean that the other Shaykh is doing something wrong. No, it just means that the ulama have various opinions of how the Prophet did something. But how the Sahabi passed it down to him, it came all the way to your Shaykh, so that's why he's implementing it that way. How the Sahabi passed it to the Shaykh, that's how he's implementing it. So on and so forth. So you look towards your shuyukh and they will restore some balance for you, rather than being confused. You look towards your shaykh, how to do wudu. The tabi'een around Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, they would say when he would come out of his house, he would do every single thing according to the sunnah of the Prophet
ﷺ.
But we mentioned this before, other reason, but look at what the tabi'een are doing. They're looking at everything he's doing. Are you realizing that? One is purpose to take that he did everything to the Sunnah. And that's the maqam of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. They did everything according to the Sunnah, from the time of coming out of his house in the morning till the time he went back into his house. And they say, we don't know why he did it in his house. Doors are closed. But look what the Tabi'is are doing. They're looking at everything Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is doing. Every single detail. Every single detail. That's how you need to be around the Shaykh. But again, being around the Shaykh has to have adab. You know, how you speak to the shuyukh, how you around shuyukh. Like he stated as well, that when you're amongst the ulama, then protect your tongue. Don't let it loose, because they will hold you account to it. When you're amongst the awliya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then protect your heart. Because they're in touch with your heart, they know your state better than you. So protect that from all evil thoughts when you come. This is why in the Shazi Tariqa, when Shaykh Imam Abul Hassan al-Shazli went to meet Ibn Mashish. And many times you find that your actual Shaykh is probably living next door to you. He went all the way to Makkah Mukarramah, went to Egypt and all the areas looking for his sheikh. When he got to Makkah, a sheikh told him, your sheikh's in Morocco, in your homeland. So he had to travel all the way back, and he went to the mountain and he climbed it up, and it roughly takes about 2-3 hours to climb it up. And his sheikh said, go back and make wuzu again. So he went back down to make wuzu. He climbed back up. His sheikh said to him, go make wuzu again. So he had to climb back down. He did that 7 times. The 7th time he thought that what? Right? I made wuzu so many times. Why does my this man, he wasn't a sheikh at the time, even my sheikh wasn't a sheikh. Why is he telling me to go back? He realized, I'm going with so many claims. I'm saying I'm this knowledgeable person, I'm an alim of the deen, I'm so and so. I do this amount of ibadat, I do that amount of ibadat. Meaning he's not controlling his heart. So he, when he climbed up for the 7th time, he emptied all that out. And this is the adab of being around the shuyukh. And it's for the ulama as well, who think that with ilm comes taqabbur. And taqabbur is it can take you to your death. In tasawwuf, I mean, it can destroy you. And there's many imams in our times who are of that. Don't just think that money is everything, and only money can destroy you. Money can destroy you as well, but for ulama, taqabbur can destroy them. Even their fame, they're attracted to fame. They need to always be talked about. That can destroy a person as well. And it's happened in the past many times. So what happened? He emptied himself from everything. And he presented himself in front of his sheikh. Now the sheikh said to him, now it's time for you to take the bayah. Now it's time, now you're empty. But for us, every time we come in front of the shuyukh, we have to empty ourselves. Regardless of what the sheikh has told you before in terms of knowledge, you empty yourself. You come like a newborn baby and say, I have no knowledge. Teach me. You sit in front of him, you learn something. Because the day you say you have knowledge, that's the day you've got taqabbur inside you. And taqabbur will destroy you. It will destroy you. And this is the way of the shirk, the sunnah way. And don't be, again, I need to mention this as well, that in this day and age, we have people who are flying. You know, they're taking people, chickens' heads off and putting them back together again. Okay? They're taking birds' heads and putting them back together again. This is not from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And don't be fooled by that. The true awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the true lovers of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are those who stay distance away from them. If karamat, don't get me wrong, we believe in karamat as well. We believe in miracles. Okay? But they're not the focal point. Miracles of awliya are not the focal point. They're good for us. You know, when you learn about the miracles of the anbiya, they're good to bring that stamina inside you to do more ibadat and become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But for the wali who's alive, it's nothing. You remember with your own shuyukh as well, that if a miracle would happen in front of them, they say just leave about it, forget about it. There's nothing. Why? Because miracles don't mean anything. It's just there for you to have more certainty in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But your goal is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Have yaqeen in them. So don't be duped by this, that I can do so and so, I can cure incurable diseases. No, you don't need to be duped by that. Sayyidina Ghawsi Azam's waqif is beautifully put upon this. That when the man came to him 40 nights and he spent 40 nights with him and said, I heard that you did so and so miracle. Miracles spread quickly. Okay? And he said, I heard so and such things about you, but I haven't seen nothing. And then Ghawsi Azam said to him, that have you seen anything that I have done against the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? That was the miracle. Him not doing anything against the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So look at that, that's what you need to look for. If miracles happen at the hands of your sheikh, then that's for you. For how, meaning that means that you're lacking in certainty in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted this sheikh a miracle, so that you can have more certainty in your sheikh, in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the awliya also mentioned that these miracles are like that dust which comes off a horse rider's horse. The goal is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the destination. He does not look towards his miracles. So we have to mention that, because these days you got many people coming into Bradford, okay, and doing these certain things. And we get masses flocking towards them. But they don't realize that this person is on the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then they say, this happens, that happens. Simple answer, what we'll do when the Dajjal will come? He's going to do greater things than this. And they'll be hakiki, then having illusions. He's chopping the heads of the chickens are all illusions. But when the Dajjal comes, it's going to be hakiki. He's going to kill somebody and bring him back to life again. He's going to kill him in front of your eyes and bring him back to life. He's going to make it rain. He's going to tell the clouds to rain, then just let the water go. He'll say, make it sunny, it'll be sunny again. And so on and so forth. Are we going to follow him in this manner? But this is where you find that, and it's unfortunate as well that these gatherings taking place and there's ulama flocking towards them. Live on TV is there, ulama sat behind it. He's doing these things live on TV and ulama sat behind it. So we find out that the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that 70,000 ulama will be from the army of the Dajjal. There's one regarding the Jews, there's one about the ulama as well. But what? They'll be duped by these things. They'll be conned by these things. Things that these things are the sign of a true wali. They're there for yakin, for you to have certainty. And they're actually a test as well. They're a test. That if the wali looks towards it, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy him. He should never look towards his miracle. Have you ever heard a shaykh talking about his own miracles? No, because it's not important. It's not important to him. What's important is for you to turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he takes you that way. And as our shaykh says, the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is easy. Take a right and go straight. That's how our shaykh says, take a right and go straight.